Jarrah rambles through most of Exhibit D, Parts 1 through 4, saying that Earth rocks and Moon rocks are identical. But he also peppers in evidence that maybe they came from someplace else.
To look at what we know, the Moon rocks collected by the astronauts do indeed contain traces of water. This finding eliminates the possibility that they are of lunar origin. Further, we know that these rocks have elements and isotopes identical to those of Earth. Yet they also contain something to suggest that they came from space, radiation.
Of course, scientists reported that NASA's moon rocks had traces of water in them back in 1970, and the same trace amounts of water were confirmed remotely on the lunar surface by the Cassini, Chandrayaan-1, and Deep Impact spacecraft. And although they share identical elements with Earth rocks, NASA's moon rocks have different proportions of those elements, making the two groups of rocks as identical as Fred and Ethel Mertz. But what's new here is Jarrah's statement that Earth rocks and moon rocks now have identical elements and isotopes. Jarrah manages to slip in a very subtle, faulty generalization that's sometimes referred to as destroying the exception. To correct Jarrah's statement, you have to add a qualifying word like many, and then state the exception. For example, moon rocks have many elements and isotopes identical to those of Earth rocks, but due to their exposure to solar and galactic radiation, moon rocks also have some additional isotopes not found in Earth rocks, which are protected from extraterrestrial radiation by the Earth's atmosphere. Jarrah ignores the exception because this particular claim becomes the foundation for a straw man that he's about to build. Actually, you could say that every rock in the universe is probably composed of the same basic collection of elements and isotopes. What makes them unique are the proportions of those elements and isotopes to one another, zero being a valid proportion, of course. And Dr. Hartman's statement that Earth rocks and Moon rocks have identical oxygen isotope ratios does not imply that they have identical isotope ratios for all elements. That's quite a stretch, and a fallacy of equivalence. We will take a deep dive into how scientists use ratios of other elements to identify the probable origins of rocks or meteorites later, but for now, we will briefly follow Jarrah down his radiation path.
The lunar materials that we've analyzed, and that others have analyzed, show evidence of having been bombarded by cosmic radiation, and which we don't see on Earth because we have an atmosphere that really shields them very effectively.
However, the moon is not the only place where you'll find radiation. Meteorites gathered on Earth also show signs of cosmic ray bombardment. This tends to suggest that the Apollo samples we have are in fact a man-made combination of Earth materials and meteorites. I can only guess that the Earth materials were added in a ceramic slab to make these rocks appear somewhat different to regular meteorites.
And I can only guess that if the only ingredients in moon rocks were water and radiation, then Jarrah might have a legitimate argument up to this point. But there is so much more that differentiates a moon rock from his terrestrial cousins, all of which Jarrah chooses to ignore. Jarrah's claim is simply another fallacy of equivalence. As for thinking you could fool a geologist into believing that a common meteorite is actually a moon rock simply because it shows signs of radiation, think again. Remember what Dr. Hartman said about oxygen isotope ratios?
When we got the rocks back from the moon, we saw that the isotopes of oxygen in the lunar rocks were exactly the same as on the Earth. Now, the reason this is important is that we have meteorites from other parts of the solar system, and each other part of the solar system has a different composition of these oxygen isotopes, ratio of one type of isotope to the other.
Jarrah plays this interview at least two or three times in his series, and yet he fails to pick up on the fact that meteorites from other parts of the solar system have different oxygen isotope ratios from Earth rocks and moon rocks. Of all the thousands of meteorites that have been discovered on Earth, only a small handful, those believed to have come from the moon, have oxygen isotope ratios similar to Earth rocks and NASA's moon rocks. the vast majority of meteorites have different oxygen isotope ratios. This totally rules out the possibility that NASA could have passed off common meteorites as moon rocks. So, at the end of the day, the only similarity between meteorites and NASA's moon rocks is that they both, as Jarrah puts it, contain radiation. And, as Dr. Hartman points out, the striking differences in oxygen isotope ratios would make it impossible for NASA to pass off one for the other. I suppose that's a luxury of being a conspiracy theorist. Your stories don't have to be ironclad, or even consistent for that matter. Just elusive. And I guess, the more elusive, the better. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators. Wherever you are.